James Bond is a renowned, not to say notorious, womanizer. Pussy Galore was just one in a long list of exotic beauties with equally fantastic names. But one woman has remained faithful in spite of that list. Miss Moneypenny, played by Lois Maxwell, and he certainly doesn't deserve you, Lois.
I don't think he does either.
Well, Bond is also renowned as a man of action, and his movies have included some of the most imaginative and exciting stunts ever filmed. And several other Bond films, including the latest one, The Man with the Golden Gun, is Guy Hamilton. And every time, Guy, I see that clip, you know, I think, fantastic, but how dangerous. How far did that boat actually jump?
When it jumps over the cars, 178 feet, I think. Which is a world record because, of course, not many people want to try it.
Exactly. Well, whose idea was it? Whose brainchild was it to put that kind of stuff?
It starts off, it actually started off in Diamonds Are Forever. We were in Vegas, Hoover Dam, lakes, lots of boats, boat chase. And I wasn't happy because I just, you know, just boats on water. And that to me is incredibly dull because you expect to see boats on water. And thinking about it, I realised that boats crossing roads, jumping over roads, and then all the cars that are chasing, they should end up in the water. That's the start of a chase that would be fun, so we set about it. Problem was, nobody'd done it. Have you ever tried to jump a boat over a car? So we borrowed the local pond and set about it, and it was absolute disaster. The first boats came up the ramp, about 10 feet, and they had to go 160 to clear the road. So we just went on and on, practicing, rehearsing. A computer gives you the answer, and the general idea is to try and not kill anybody.
Right. Well, what happened? You said their computer, and I mean, one thinks of this on ponds and so on, but what about on location?
Well, I won't shoot anything until I've actually seen it and rehearsed it, so that this is pre-production, before you start shooting. I have an assistant director and the stunt drivers, and we go on and we go on till we've got it right. Part of the secret is normally you're going to do it with a real brick wall, so that to give the lads confidence, we do it with a paper wall. And they keep on going through the paper wall, and then eventually
they go over it
and then do it once more over the paper wall, and now everybody happy, okay, let's put the real wall in, close our eyes and keep everything crossed.
Well, what about damage and injuries and that kind
of thing? Well, the worst injury was, because there's nothing very Chinese about driving motorboats if you practice a little bit, and so I got Roger Moore out 10 days before we started shooting, and he said, oh, I can do that, it's no problem at all, so off he went. And unfortunately was in a jet-powered boat that has no rudder, and it ran out of petrol doing about 80 miles an hour around a bend, and Roger went straight into the bank, into a tree, broke a tooth, hurt his knee, and we hadn't started shooting James Bond, and our leading man was a cripple with a hole in
his
teeth to start.
Yeah, well, that answers the question, of course. But many people, you know, want to know: do the actors actually ever do their own stunts? Oh no, let me bring you in here because we saw you there flipping Sean Connery over your shoulder. Were you involved in a lot of difficult situations like that in Pussy Galore?
As Pussy Galore, that was the main fighting I did. I mean, previously in the Avengers, I'd done lots. And the thing about Pussy Galore was so super because, I mean, I never had an adversary like Sean in the Avengers. And you cut the bit that was lovely at the end, you know, when I get kissed, which was nice. And I've never finished up a fight like that before. No, it was super because Guy was kind enough to give me hay to fall on and so forth. I didn't tear my back on the cement floor or anything, and it was lovely. That was the nicest fight I think I've ever had, and I was in great trim. And, well...
So it didn't worry you at all? I mean, that kind of stunting and...
No. Well, no, by then I'd done so much.
You're
one always
fit.
Thinks, oh, my God, let's hope it goes all right, you know, but... after so long and touch wood everything did, one forgets about it. One just wants to do it right. This is where the butterflies come from. Mm. You mustn't make a mess of it, especially since you're a girl. Yeah. See what I mean?
Well, Lois, of course, as Miss Moneypenny, you never get into those kind of difficult situations. What's the most difficult one you've ever been in?
Most difficult one is that I always want to kiss the guy, and I never manage to.
But you're always on, as the part actually is, always on the outside looking in. Have you yourself ever wanted them to write in a bit more sort of dramatic action into Miss Moneypenny and perhaps suggested
indeed,
something?
Indeed, yes. Diamonds Are Forever. I heard that they hadn't even written Miss Moneypenny in the script. So I said, well, obviously they want to get rid of me. So I telephoned Harry Salzman. I said, Harry, I have the most magnificent idea. I have my pilot's license now. And why don't you send Moneypenny to Las Vegas and she will land in her little Cherokee. Of course, the audience will know who I am, but the villains don't. And that night in the casino, she'll be there all dressed up in a marvelous backless dress and covering the freckles, there will be micro dots. And Bond will see her and come over and peel off the micro dots and put them on his moles.
That's great. Can't wait.
And meantime, the villains get a little suspicious of this strange woman who doesn't really speak to anyone, mm-hmm. and they check up with London, and they find that it's Moneypenny. So the next morning, when she climbs into her trusty Cherokee and takes off into the clouds in the dawn of Las Vegas, boom! A terrible, terrible explosion.
But you've written yourself out of the script. Out of the film.
Ah, but I'd much rather go up in a ball of flames than be superannuated.
Which is what's happening, oh God. What is this deep, dark secret, then, that Moneypenny's got with James Bond that we're always kind of having to make up our own minds about?
May I tell them, Guy?
Yes.
May I tell them?
Your version.
My version. When Moneypenny was a young secretary in the typing pool, and Bond was a tea boy, as he was taking lessons in pistol shooting and one thing and another, they felt rather attracted to each other, and they went away for a sort of very long weekend. And they appreciated each other very much, and there was a great deal of affection. And Moneypenny knew that if she fell in love with Bond, really fell in love with him, that her heart would be broken forever. And he realized that if he fell in love with her, he'd have to marry her. So after that long weekend, they just never got together again. But they have deep affection and, as I say, appreciation for each other's talent.
Oh, that's lovely, isn't it?
This is Stanislavski, taken to the nth degree, isn't it?
Guy, you've directed now quite a few of the Bond movies, and they are tremendously successful. Have you any secret formula of this success? What's the ingredients you think necessary?
I think the basic success is that the people who make them still care and don't get lazy. I mean, if you say, all right, we gave the public that last time, they enjoyed it, let's give them another boat chase, let's, you know, sort of do a variant of what we did last time, then the public are going to say, oh, we've seen that. One of the joys, I think, or we hope, that when you go and see a Bond movie, you sort of know the ground rules, which to me is important, but you don't know what's coming next. And
what
you
about
haven't
James
seen
Bond
it before.
What about James Bond as a character himself? I mean, what is the appeal of this man? What's the attraction, do you think, from a man's point of view?
Well, he's everything that every man wishes that he could do. You know, when a meter maid comes up to you and says and starts writing out a ticket, you'd love to, you know, put her in the back of the car, but you haven't got enough nerve. And Bond is the man who will show you the answer to that problem that happens to happen to every man, woman in the country.
What about for a woman's point of view, Arno? What do you think the attraction of James Bond is?
I think it's sort of traditional in women, coming from way back. It has nothing to do with women's lib, let's face it. I think that there is just that part of them that wants a great big hero. And he is a great big hero, and you always feel you'd be safe with him, and he could get out of anything. Mm. And he's sexy as hell. I mean, I don't think there's much more you could want of a man than Bond.
How different is he from the original, though, Ian Fleming Bond? Out of the novels, Guy. I mean, the film Bond to the book Bond.
Fleming was writing very much about a Commander Bond, Royal Navy, which I like to sort of bring back occasionally to remind the audience. The dragons have changed. Fleming was always writing about the Russians as the villains, the Cold War. Life has gone on, and so to me the problem these days is to find the dragon, because Bond is St. George, and he's a private method of being St. George, but ultimately he's killing dragons for the benefit of mankind.
It is the old story, isn't it? Good over evil and all this kind of thing, which provides us a good family viewing. Now, if you actually met Ian Fleming, didn't you?
Yes,
I do. Do you think that in a way James Bond was him? Did you get this feeling? He's writing about himself, perhaps?
Perhaps in a minor way. I think he was also writing about what he would have liked to have been, because Ian was a very attractive man, not in a conventional attractiveness, but he was very attractive and very dishy and very sexy, but with this cool, you know, tremendous cool. You could see himself. I mean, I could see him in a Bond situation.
Did he approve of you as Miss Moneypenny?
Oh, yes, he did. He did. And the last time I saw him, just before he died, he said that one of these days he was going to get Bond into a diabolical situation and only Moneypenny would be able to save him, because he had said that Moneypenny had the most kissable lips in the world.
Oh,
and all this, you know, he was really
marvellous guy. What about these Bond girls, Anna? Because what does it feel like to be made one? It seems to me, you know, every time they announce a Bond film, the Bond girl is rather like Miss World. I mean, is this what it's like to you, or was like?
It didn't occur to me at all at the time, no. I mean, it was a part one played, a part one enjoyed, one knew guy, one liked guy, one had fun on the film. And I wasn't really shaken by this character till I went on a promotion tour of the States with the picture. And hardly any of the interviewers would call me by my character name. They said, how do you feel about playing a character with this name? And don't you find it rather distasteful and all this? And they really took it so seriously,
yeah,
you know.
Exactly.
I sent them up rotten. It was awful, because they'd been given instructions from above that they mustn't say Pussy galore.
this is the whole thing about Bond women, Guy, that they send women up rotten. I mean, are they just the sex in the movie? It's the same part with a sort of more exotic package and a more sort of exotic name.
Well, one of the tragedies of life is that men motivate things. James Bond is a motivator. He goes to point A, and he knows why he's going to point A. And if he meets a girl on the way, you know, it is to be used for the situation, his mission. It's very difficult to write a good Bond lady's part. It really is very difficult, because they're there as part of the scenery. We try very hard to give
nice,
them character. Now,
well,
Pussy was a success. Pussy was
yes,
a success.
Because, yes, she survived,
I mean,
her great
claim to fame was that she was the only girl who was not impressed with James Bond, didn't want to go to bed with him.
But if you say that you've got to keep people's interest going, then surely you've got to keep the film updated. I mean, isn't it about time Women's Lib moved in and James Bond
became... I think that it's high time that James Bond met Women's Lib, and don't think we haven't been playing around in that area.
Oh, good, so it might be on the come. Well, you did bring in the villains things, and this is where the films have begun to change a bit. What's the ingredient, then, for a successful villain, do you think,
well,
nowadays?
Bond
it used to be just the Russians, didn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, Bond is as good as his villains. I mean, if he's got no opposition, then what he does is pretty meaningless. The better the villains are, the better Bond is, because they make better problems for him. I like two villains. I like a Mr. Big, who is as intelligent as Bond, always very rich, so that we don't have to go in the back alleys of Marseilles or Southend. Mr. Big has, if he has an aeroplane, it has a swimming pool in it. If he has an island, it's a private island. I mean, you know.
Except that I never know why men of such bigness and wealth have to be villains, you see.
Ah, because they have an evil idea. They want to use their power or their wealth for something which you, the audience, must understand that if they were successful would mean that the price of petrol will go up even more, that something terrible will happen, and therefore, Bond, please do something about it. Mm. But Mr. Big, I think, also says, I hate the sight of blood, and so now that you've discovered my terrible secret, Mr. Bond, you will excuse me whilst I hand you over to my staff to deal with you. And now the staff are the heavy gang. and the heavy gang can't just be characterless goons. Mm. They have to be interesting.
The henchmen, as it were.
The henchmen.
Who's your favourite henchman, Anna, do you think? Who was the one that you were up against? Although you were a villain, weren't you? A bit of a villain in As Pussy Galore.
Yes, I was. That beautiful bald chap, what was his
name?
What was his name?
Oh, Oddjob, that's
yes,
right.
Yes, he was my yes. favourite. What about you, Lois? Which was your favourite villain?
I think it was Robert Shaw, probably, and from Russia with Love.
It's all sex with money, isn't it? So it's all the nice fellas all the time, it really is. Well, the thing that always occurs to me whenever I watch the Bond movies is these. If you do work on them, you go to the most wonderful places on earth. You work in the sun, in fantastic locations. What was your location, Anna?
The furthest I went was Northolt Airport. That's all I ever did. Everybody thinks I was in California or Miami or something, but
no, really?
But no, just Northolt Airport, that's all.
What about you, Lois?
I'm stuck in the office in Pinewood all the time.
So you never
Although
get to anything.
No, they did take me. They did take me to Portugal for a few days
we can't
when he was married.
She was going to say Portugal.
But you do, don't you, to fantastic locations.
Yes,
guy.
I mean, let us not complain that one goes around the world looking for things, but when you get there, it's tremendously like hard work, and the conditions are very, very rough. To take 160 people into the middle of nowhere, accommodation, very long hours, always problems with the weather, with heat, equipment breaking down. It's no picnic.
Mm. Well, that the most crucial part now, I read in the newspapers this weekend a lovely quote. It said, at one time, the adage was to an actor, never work with children or animals. And now they feel that you ought to add stunts onto this if you happen to be in the Bond movies. Would you agree with that, Guy, that the stunts now are, what, 70% of the movie, the success of the movie?
No, no.
No?
They are part and parcel of, but they're a small part. Roger wouldn't agree because he does the stunts. He says, the more things that I can do, the more terrific. Mm. I think if the girl happens to be sitting next to Roger and going through the stunt, this is a great part for the girl because she says, I wish I wasn't here. You know, it's...
Must be a bit of a problem, though, Guy, to keep thinking up bigger and better things for each movie that comes along. Where do you get your ideas from for these fantastic
stuff? Mostly from Tomorrow's World.
Really?
Yes, because Bond is not fantasy. They have to be things that can actually happen. And so I watch a terrific new tin opener that's been invented, you know, and all you housewives, you know, you won't get your fingers cut and this, that and the other thing. It's rather interesting. Mm. But then, don't use it to open a tin. I mean, could you open a safe with it? Could you make a hole in an aeroplane? Reversing. It's always reverses. I mean, I'm always thinking of if James Bond was on a bicycle and was being chased by a tank, how could he win? Because you start off by saying, oh, he's on a hiding to nothing. How could you
use... Is that how you involve your audience as well?
Yes, of course, because they say, idiot, you know, you're being chased by a tank and you jump on a bicycle that happens to be there.
Just happens to be there.
You won't get very far. And then, but Bond is a genius and will say, you know, when I am riding a bicycle, it's quite a different story.
Yeah, it just happens to be a ladder in a snake pit and this kind of thing. We're all groaning like mad in the audience. What about the new film, then? What marvellous, fantastic, bigger than... better than anything
well,
stunts have you got?
Well, we've done something that's never been done with a car before, because you need a lot of nerve to do another car chase, and I don't mind that if you have something that the public haven't seen, and we've got it.
What have you got? Tell us.
He won't tell you, I'm sure.
Yes, if you want to see a car turn 360 degrees in the air with James Bond in it, it's worth seeing.
Dear God.
That sounds pretty dangerous. How long did it take you to work that one out?
Months. And we shot it once, and the man who did it had never done it before. He just had to trust, again, the computer.
Can you explain what this computer is, then? You just feed all the relevant details?
You feed in the relevant details. I mean, first of all, the computer will tell you whether it's possible or not. I mean, it is the idea of taking a car and you run it up a bridge over a river, and the car will go like that, and land on the other side of the river. It'd be a nice stunt to see.
But can the computer say anything about the nerve of the man or whatever?
No, that's you have to find.
Yes.
That you have to find, the idiot.
It wouldn't be me.
No, I mean, yes, again, on occasion when you... how many takes do you have to do?
Did you kill him?
One take, and it worked?
Yes.
What other things are in the film as well as the car? I mean, are there other stunts as well?
Oh, yes, but can't sit here talking about stunts. Go and see the film.
Yeah. Well, what about the future of James Bond then? I mean, it seems to me now we're coming to the end of Ian Fleming's novels. Do you ever see the day when he'll disappear off the screen, as in fact the novel's finished because Fleming died?
Well, there are certainly four more Fleming novels, and I think that so long as the people who make them stay fresh, realise, as you say, women's lib, Bond may turn up in a love story, a very genuine love story. So long as you don't repeat yourself, Bond has all the elements that when I was a kid I think movies are about. They're adventure, excitement, suspense, laughs, pretty girls.
It's still the same.
It's still the same.
Don't you think they've changed on much at all from the beginning?
Not those kind of adventure stories, no. I think the same elements still apply. I mean, the little boys would rather do without the female bit. My son, who thinks, here comes Bond.
I just wonder if it's me that's changed them, perhaps.
Yes, of course. Bond is from 7 to 70, and you fit in there somewhere.
Yes, I think that more children perhaps do go to see them, though, nowadays.
And everybody likes an adventure.
Yeah.
Everybody.
She's going to start again. You better
watch it. She's going to start the sex thing again, isn't it? Thank you very much. No, you'll get him in the end. I know you will. Thank you very much. Very much an honour, Blackman. It's super to have you.